This week, then, we're going to be looking at writing our own custom attributes. So this leads on from a couple of videos that I've done previously on the built-in attributes in .NET and then on reflection. And in the reflection video, which was the last one I did, I showed you how to put together a general purpose tool for creating reports from data structures. But the limitations of it were, because it was general purpose, it did them all in a very, very similar way. And what we needed to do was to be able to customize the way these reports came out. And that's what we're going to do with custom attributes. And so just to recap, we had a couple of data structures. We had this weather data structure with some dummy data. We had this book data structure with some other dummy data. And then our CSV generator was a generic. So we were instantiating it for book and for weather. And then it used reflection, so it got hold of the type, and then from the type it got hold of the properties and processed those to produce the output. And so in our program we just generated both of those. And if I were to run that up and then look in the folder and drill down, there we can see it's got a books.csv and a weather.csv. and if we look at those in Excel, we can see it's got the data. You remember I mentioned this problem Excel has in that it doesn't understand dates before 1900, so that's why that's a bit of a mess. But that's nothing to do with our program or the CSV. That's Excel's problem. So there we've got that for the books report, and there we've got the weather report. Similar sort of thing. But then we did mention the limitations on this, the problems we're trying to solve. So one of the problems we've got is that the column headers are exactly the same name as the property, which you don't necessarily want. You certainly at least want to put a space in there between the two words if there's more than one word. We also had the problem that the column order was as described by the class. So if we look back at our weather, it just happens to go city description, temperature centigrade, rainfall inches. That's the order we get it in. We might want it to look different. And then we also had the problem that we haven't been able to specify any kind of decimal places on those doubles. You might want it one or two decimal places. And we also had the problem that it would be nicer if we could actually display the units within those columns. So if I could actually put something like inches in there rather than have inches in the header at the top. And so those are the things that we're going to fix with our custom attributes. And so the first thing that we'll do with all of that is actually write an attribute class that is going to allow us to convey all that information for each and every one of our properties. And so we'll add that in here. I'm just putting this all together in the same project, but essentially this attribute and that CSV generator class, those should go together probably in a separate DLL because they are completely reusable and they're independent from the book and the weather and whatever other data types you have. So what we're going to call this is we'll call this report item attribute. So the convention is attributes always end with the word attribute, and then we have something descriptive before that, and then we'll make that public. And then the other thing we have to do with an attribute is we also derive it from a standard class called attribute. So that's a bit of repetition with that naming convention, but that's what we do. Then we've got to remember the things that we want to do are we want to be able to do formatting, we want to be able to change the header text, we want to be able to make sure the order goes correctly, the order of the columns, and we want to be able to put units on the end. Now, of those, we have to decide which of those are going to be compulsory features that whoever uses this attribute has to provide, and what's going to be optional. And I would say the only compulsory one is the column order. Everything else should be optional. And the way we do that is we put the compulsory ones as constructor parameters. So I could have a constructor on here, and I will just give that an int called column order, and that will be the compulsory one. Then for the optional ones, we provide those as get set properties. So I'm going to have a prop that I'll have of type string and call heading. So that's what we're going to define for the column heading. I'm going to have a property again of type string called units. So if we've got any units, like we wanted inches or whatever. And then I'm also going to have another one of a string. Don't have to be strings, but it's quite common they are. And we're going to call that format. So that's where we can provide any formatting information for how it should be displayed. We still also actually need a further one to have for that column order, the compulsory one. But this one, which is going to be an int, I'm going to call column order again. But I'm going to make it get only because it's going to be set through the constructor. So now we can just say column order, the property equals column order, the parameter. And really, that's all we need to do on our attribute. In some cases, you might also put on the attribute one or more static methods to actually do the processing. But here, our processing is happening in the CSV generator, so that's separated out. So essentially, the attribute just needs to contain the data that's required. Now, before we actually write the processing, let's use that on our data classes. So let's go to book. And on each of those, we're going to put an instance of this attribute. And you'll remember that when we use an attribute, we miss off that last word attribute that was used as part of the naming convention. So the class is called reportItemAttribute, but here we just say reportItem. And remember, the only compulsory thing is the column order. And I'm going to put a 2 in there. And then I'm going to make title be number 1. So I'd like title, author, and then we'll just have date of publication as 3, and we'll have rating as 4. Okay, so just a slight change from what's there, but it'll just show the principle. But then we have to consider the optional ones. Now, author isn't going to have units. The name of the property, we're going to say, is perfectly good as the name of the column heading, so we don't need to change that, and it doesn't need any special formatting. Same goes for title, same actually goes for rating, but on date of publication, we wanted to have both some formatting and we wanted to change the name of the column heading. So now, with the optional ones, we use a slightly weird syntax because it looks like it's part of the constructor, but actually it's setting the properties. So I'm going to say heading equals, and then we'll just have a slightly more friendly version of that. So put some spaces in, make the O lowercase. And then in terms of format, I'm just going to use standard date formatting. So I'm going to make this DD MM YYYY. Okay, so that's the optional ones filled in on there. Let's do the same sort of thing on our weather. And in this case, let's just keep it simple. We will leave the order exactly the same as it's laid out. So I'll just put those in there and go 2, 3, and 4. And then what we'll need to do is city is okay, nothing to change there. Description is okay, but both of these other two, in this case, we're going to need to put in a heading, which is going to be simply temperature. We're going to put in a units, which is going to be degrees, which I think is Alt-0176, and then centigrade. And then on the last one, we're going to need all three of them. So the heading is going to be rainfall. The units is going to be inches. And then we're also going to have a format. And let's just put that in as N2. So again, like with the date, it's standard formatting notation, N2, numeric, 2 decimal places. So that's set all of that up, and that will then be what is read in by the CSV generator to process this. So let's go and do that now. So what I'm going to do is change this slightly. I'm going to get rid of these 2 create items. And then in here, I'm still going to have a create item, but all it's going to take is the property and the item. Okay, so the 2 things we need, remember the item has the data and the property has the metadata. So let's just generate a stub for that, which we can see down there. And so what I now need to do is get from that property the attribute, the report item attribute. And the way we can do that is we can just say var attribute equals, and then we'll say prop dot. And the thing to watch out for here is you can see we've got this property on there called attributes. And that's quite deceptive because it's not actually what you want. We've also, further down, got custom attributes, which is what you want to have. But attributes actually just gives us basic information about the type that follows the rules of the language. So if this were a class, it would be things like whether it's sealed or abstract, all those sorts of things. It's not an extensible system. We want the custom attributes. But actually, in practice, we tend not to go through that property because we've already got a method called getCustomAttribute, and that takes as a generic parameter the type of the attribute we're after, which in our case is our report item attribute. So if we do that, that will give us back the report item attribute instance on this particular property, or it'll give us back null if there isn't one there at all. Just notice actually my return type that it generated there is wrong because this is going to return a string. But then what we've got to do with that attribute is get hold of the information and use it. So in the case of displaying the item, we're interested in the formatting and we're interested in the units that you might want to put on the end. So what we're going to do here is we're going to say return, and then I'm going to use string.format. And then things actually get a little bit weird because it's quite tricky to get that format string in there. I mean, the easy thing to do would be to just do something like this. We could just do position 0, colon, and say we knew what the format was. We could put, say, n2 directly in there. And then we could say prop.getValueItem, just like we did before, and that would give us back the item, convert it to a string using n2 format. The problem is, though, that formatting is itself a variable that we've got in our attribute. So we have to do something a bit sneaky here. We've got to actually use string interpolation. Now, the problem with string interpolation is it now has its own meaning for the curly braces. So we've got to escape those curly braces so they will be interpreted as a single curly brace. And then the n2 we replace with another set of curly braces, and in there we put attribute.format. So that's the format we set up previously. So it's a bit fiddly that, but you can see how that works. So that means that that will be inserted into the first phase of the formatting, and then that value formatted will be inserted in the second phase. And then while we're here, the other thing remember we need to do is on the end of there, again, using the string interpolation, we do attr.units. And so that will sort out our units for us. Okay, so the column headers are still going to be wrong, but let's give that a go in terms of what we've got. And so let's look at those generated files. And if we look at books, let's look at this one in the raw Notepad version. But we can see it's done the dates in that format we asked for. So remember, on our book, we said we wanted day, dash, month, dash, year. Well, that's precisely what we've got there. If we look at our weather, and let's look at this one in Excel, we can see that it's displayed the temperature as degrees C. It's displayed the rainfall as inches and has put that to two decimal places. We probably should have actually made that space. So maybe one slight change we should make. And on our weather, put space inches on there. But apart from that, that's all working pretty well. Now we need to sort out the other things, which are the column headers and also the sort order. So what we will need to do is go back to our generator and let's go to the create header. And so we're getting hold of the properties. And then what we're going to need to do is we're going to need to sort those in terms of the order that we put into the property. So we're going to say properties.orderby. And then let's have P for property gives P.getCustomAttribute. Again, we want the report item attribute dot column order. And then, of course, remember that that doesn't modify properties. That produces a new collection. So we'll call this ordered properties, ordered props, equals that. And then we'll put the ordered props into our for each. So that should sort out the ordering. But then the other thing we've got to remember is we don't necessarily want to use the property name. We may want to use the property heading provided in the attribute. Though, of course, we may not. If that's null, we don't want to use it. And so the way to do that, we can, again, get hold of the attribute. So we'll say var attr equals prop dot, and then just steal that bit of code. So that will give us the attribute. And then if we say attr dot heading, but then because that may be null, we'll use the double question mark, the coalescing operator, and that will give us either the name or the heading if there is a heading. That's ordered the column headers, but not the actual fields themselves. So what I need to do, simply enough, is just add exactly the same bit of code. So let's get those ordered properties in there. And then use that in here. And that will sort everything out. And so now when we run it up, and if we take a look at our books, we can see it's now saying title, author, date of publication, rating, which matches the ordering we had on there. So the numbers don't really matter. It's the order of the numbers. We could have put 10, 20, 30, 40. It would still work in the same way. And if we look at the other one for weather, we can see it's now just temperature and rainfall. One other thing I wanted to mention there is at the moment we have an attribute that can actually be applied to any C# construct. Our intent is it's only applied to properties, but remember we talked about targeting when we talked about attributes, and they can be targeted to all sorts of different constructs. And at the moment, it would be perfectly okay for us to take that report item and apply it to a book. Now, obviously our processing will completely ignore that, but it's still not very nice for the user to be able to put that in there, only for it to be ignored. So if we go right back to our report item, what you will very commonly do when you declare an attribute is you give it itself an attribute. So the attribute we have is called the attribute usage attribute, and that will only apply to things derived from attribute. And on there, we can specify a number of things. We can specify the thing we're interested in here is the attribute targets, and then we get this full list of possibilities. And we want it only to be applied to properties. And so if we put that on there, then immediately now, if we go back to books, you'll see we're getting an error saying that we're not allowed to put it on anything but a property. That list, again, can have multiple things. So in this sort of case, although we haven't done it, it's conceivable you might want to have it applicable to properties and to fields. So you could do that, but we're not going to do that. And then the other couple of things you've got in there, you can see you've got whether it's inherited. So if the property applies to a base class, whether it also applies to a derived class, and also allow multiple. It's conceivable that you might want to have situations where you have multiple instances of the same attribute, but with different values. Suppose you were having an attribute that you used to mark the developer that had written a particular method or property or whatever in your code. Well, it's conceivable you could have two different developers working on it. So rather than have a list of developers in the one attribute, you could use that attribute twice. But it defaults to false because that's not normally what you want to do. So we have that attribute target of property, and that just makes things a bit safer. So that was it for custom attributes. We had quite a practical example there. I've used this in a more complex situation, but in a number of different applications when you want to do reporting. And you can see we've got the idea of adding the metadata to our properties. The property basically can only tell us in terms of C# language what the data type is, double, string, date, time, whatever, what the name of the property is. But we wanted to go beyond that, and we've seen we can choose whatever we want and put that data into our attribute. So I hope you find that helpful. If you did, do please click like, do subscribe, and I'll see you next time.